Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. Nice to see everybody here. Sorry, fiddling with my microphone. We come together. The Lord has gathered us again. And we come together in his name, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Father, you are holy, and we want to praise you this morning. We thank you that such a holy God allows us to come into your presence. And so we thank you for the gift of Jesus who made that way possible for us. Be with us this morning as we worship. We know you are. We know that you are always with us. We pray that our worship will be acceptable to you and that we will have hearts that are ready and willing to hear all that you have for us this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have a reading from Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 11 to 16 and 20 to 24. For this is what the Sovereign Lord says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so will I look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries, and I will bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel, in the ravines, and in all the settlements in the land. I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land, and there they will feed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lay down, declares the Sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak, but the sleek and the strong I will destroy. I will shepherd the flock with justice. Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to them. See, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you shove with flank and shoulder, butting all the weak sheep with your horns until you have driven them away. I will save my flock, and they will no longer be plundered. I will judge between one sheep and another. I will replace over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. He will tend them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Now, Ezekiel speaks of the shepherd who searches for lost sheep, rescues them from danger and feeds them from rich pastures. And this manner of shepherding is what Jesus does for us. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Do we realize how blessed we are to have a shepherd like this? Our shepherd knows us intimately. He knows everything about us. And we can feel safe and secure in his care. But then we often wander, as sheep are wont to do. We stray from the path that he's chosen for us. And we forget to listen for his voice. Indeed, at times we don't even recognize his voice. At times we deliberately walk away and disobey. Let's take a moment to come before the Lord and confess those times when we have chosen our own way. And I invite you, if you will, to join with me in the confession on the screen. Tender, comforting shepherd, your steadfast love is present in this place and resides within each of us. But sometimes it's hard to open ourselves to your love. We feel like scattered sheep, frightened and alone. Forgive us for those times when we willfully walk away from you. Help us know your loving presence as we live as your gathered community. Enlighten our hearts that we may know the hope to which we have been called, and may we grow in our desire to know you more and love you better. Because there is no greater joy than in knowing you, our shepherd and king. Let's just take a moment for our personal confession. The Lord sees your heart and he's heard your confession. And I can tell you, in Jesus' name, you are forgiven. Be free in the knowledge that you are loved beyond understanding, forgiven, set free, and be at peace. Amen.
Testament reading today comes from the Epistle to the Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation, so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning, everyone. The message today, our Lord, who is our shepherd and our King. I'll just open in prayer. Father, we've just sang, open the eyes of our hearts. That is our desire, Lord, this morning, that you would do that and that we would know you better. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the passage that we are looking at today comes from the book of Ezekiel. Now, that's the longest book in the Bible. I've never done a Bible study on Ezekiel. So there wasn't very much that I knew about him as a prophet. But he began prophesying to the people of Jerusalem about 7 years before the fall of Babylon. And he was taken away with the exiles, probably about 10 years after Daniel. So he was in Babylon with Daniel. And he was prophesying about the same time as Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah was not taken to Babylon. He remained in Israel, but then later on Jeremiah went south into Egypt, but that's another story. So, and when Ezekiel was in Babylon, he actually prophesied about for about 14 years to the exiles in Babylon. So the book of Ezekiel is very difficult to understand. That's probably why I haven't done a Bible study on it. That's why we probably don't hear him very much. But the chapter that we're looking at today, chapter 34, is fairly straightforward, and it's a very important chapter. God is letting his people know that he himself will be their shepherd, and also he himself, he says, will be their king. So God being pictured as both shepherd and king is not strange in the Bible. In the Bible, leaders of the people were called shepherds. So the kings, the magistrates, the judicial system, the leaders of that, they were called shepherds. And also the priests were also called shepherds. So living in an agrarian society, you know, much before our industrialised cities, the pictures of shepherds would have been well understood. They had the care and the concern and the control of their sheep. And this was easily translated to the leaders of Israel. But above all of those leaders, there was God. And he is mentioned about 100 times as being the shepherd of Israel. So you could say that this is a key characteristic or a key attribute of God. I mean, we know the Psalm 23 really well. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So the human leaders, as shepherds, they were to be God's representatives. At the beginning of chapter 34, which we didn't read, God is condemning these leaders. They have not taken care of the flock, but rather they have taken care of themselves. They have, it says, eaten the curds, clothed themselves with the wool, and slaughtered the choice animals for themselves. They have been, in a nutshell, selfish and self-indulgent. They have looked after themselves to the detriment of the people of Israel. God says, you have not strengthened the weak or healed the sick or bound up the injured. You have not brought back the strays or searched for the lost. You have ruled them harshly and brutally, so they were scattered because there was no shepherd. And when they were scattered, they became food for the wild animals. So imagine the sheep scattered about and exposed without the shepherd. Well, it's a veritable smorgasbord for those wild animals, isn't it? So am I taking a leap too far when I say, is this what we look like to Satan when we are outside of God's fold, exposed and vulnerable to his deceits, his tricks, and his lies? A sheep needs a shepherd, or it will be in danger, big time. So humanity, us, we're called sheep approximately 400 times in the Bible. And so it's important to understand who we are. But that term is rather insulting, because sheep are thought to be quite stupid. They have no sense of direction like cats or dogs. They're very obstinate, being difficult to round up and bring home. That's why we have sheepdogs. Hence the need for a sheepdog. One pastor who has been a shepherd said he had to bind up the legs of the sheep and carry it home over his shoulder because the sheep thinks it knows better than the shepherd. They are not clean, cuddly animals that we think of, but rather are full of ticks, lice and worms, and constantly need to be sanitised and cleaned. Are you getting the picture of humanity? They're beginning to resemble me. They cannot find food for themselves. Sheep never take the long view. They will eat everything around them until it's all gone and then stand there in nothing. The shepherd has to move them on to greener pastures. The sheep are utterly helpless and utterly foolish. This is a picture of the human race. So how like the sheep are we? We want what we want and we want it now. You heard of that little girl singing in Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory? I want it now. I'm a little bit like that when I see chocolate too. We very rarely take the long view. I complain about politicians never taking the long view, but I wonder how many times in my life I have satisfied my needs to the detriment of others. Isaiah says, "We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way." The shepherd takes care of our physical needs, but the Bible talks about spiritual needs. Our souls need a shepherd, but we go astray by feeding our souls with stuff which isn't good for it. We put our hope in the wrong things and we don't understand what truth is because we accept the lies that society spins. We, by ourselves, cannot find our way to the sheep pen. But there's more to this passage than just sheep and shepherds. We see that God himself will become Israel's leader, Israel's king, and he will do this through a descendant of King David. "I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince," my brackets king, "among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. They shall know that I, the Lord, their God, am with them, and that they, the house of Israel, are my people, says the Lord. You are my sheep, the sheep of my pasture, and I am your God, says the Lord." So here we see both shepherd and king. So we can hear Jesus' voice telling us in John 10, which Marian reminded us about earlier, that he, Jesus, is the good shepherd. And in Matthew 1, we read that Jesus is a descendant of King David. Jesus has come to care for his sheep, but also as king, to bring in his rule and his reign in his kingdom. He is sovereign, and this brings us to our Ephesian reading. Paul is praying for the Ephesians on the basis of God's sovereignty. Because of the birth, death, and resurrection of Jesus the Messiah, the world is now a different place. God's kingdom has been ushered in, and it is God who is king, regardless of what the powers in Rome thought, regardless of what the powers today think. Look what's happening. But God is king today. A king in today's world really has no power. We think of Prince King Charles, he's rather just a figurehead. But in the biblical world, a king is the one to whom total obedience is due and from whom one can expect protection, help, and the rightings of wrongs. Well, this is a very different concept for us who have never had to bow the knee to anyone, because we live in a democracy and we feel that we have equal rights with everyone and anyone. But once we are in the kingdom of God, we do not live in a democracy, but rather a theocracy, with God as supreme ruler and Lord. So at the beginning of chapter 1 of Ephesians, Paul describes God's sovereignty, or his kingship, for those who believe the marvellous things, and these things will happen in their lives. We were chosen before the creation of the world. You are not a random selection of molecules roaming about this world or an afterthought. You were chosen to be here. Just as you are a perfect specimen of humanity made in the image of God. We have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Are you guilty of something? Guilty of anything? Just ask for his forgiveness and he will give it. Freely he will give it. He will take that burden from you and joy will follow. Just give it to him. And we have glorious grace. The riches of his grace has been lavished on us and again freely given to us. Undeservedly, he showers us with the riches of his love as he blesses us with the Holy Spirit. He is all powerful. He is the King. Christ was raised from the dead and seated at the right hand of the Father, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet. And this wonderful King suffered for us. And we see our Lamb, a Lamb as our Shepherd King. For the Lamb at the centre of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. If you are living in the world with a different worldview than this, a different worldview than the gospel, you are living in a false reality. If you do not acknowledge Jesus as King and you run your own race, you are living in a make-believe world, making it up as you go along or following others who have made it up to suit themselves. So, just to wrap it up, God is our shepherd, protecting us from the wiles of Satan and keeping us close to him as we navigate life's path. God is our King, and we live in his kingdom under his rule with all the benefits of forgiveness, grace, love, and belonging. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come in worship and praise today as we look into what you have done in our world because you love us. Your love is too big for us to comprehend. Help us to submit to your rule in our lives, we pray. Amen.
Fire of the Go out into the world and in your words and in your lives, bear witness to the Christ who has ascended to be everywhere present. And as you come to know him better, may God give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation. May Christ Jesus lift up his hands and bless you. And may the Spirit open to you all the riches of Christ's inheritance. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.